Welcome to the COVID countdown, and today I am Elizabeth McHenry, aka Aesthetic Professor. I'm here with Susan Voss with the Salon Spa Connection, and our guest today is Kevin Deal with WellSpring Massage Therapy Institute. You teach massage there, correct?
Yes, teach the advanced levels, and then in the assistant or the associate's program.
Very good.
How long have you been teaching there?
Oh God, 12, 13 years.
Oh, wow.
I got to be a guest speaker there years ago. I think it might've been in 2005 or six. I came there and taught a hydrotherapy course.
Oh, fun.
Yeah. And then I had a training academy with a business partner. We had an actual hydrotherapy treatment room. I don't know if you knew this, Susan, but we had a hydrotherapy tub where you could do underwater massage. And all these different kinds of things. We had beachy shower, we had the whole thing. So sometimes they would send the students from there over to our academy to train, and sometimes I get to come over there and be a guest speaker. But it's been a long time since I've been there. I'm glad to hear that they're still open.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Yeah. That's a nice setup you had.
Yeah, you guys.
WellSpring's not the only school now, I think. Correct? Isn't that the only school for massage, WellSpring, in Kansas City?
No, I'm not sure. Is Pinnacle still around? I'm not sure. We're one of the last remaining, let's put it that way. Yes.
Right. As opposed to 25 barber cosmetology schools in Kansas City.
A few of them.
Yeah, but everybody has hair, so let's remember this. Well, some of them.
Hello.
So you see that handsome mug of yours, you got some hair there. Barbers need to know how
I went to Santa Claus for the Christmas party this year. The beard was down to about here. So I trimmed that off.
That's awesome.
Kevin, school is not in session, correct?
It is not. We've been closed since basically St. Patty's Day.
Oh, wow. And are you all doing online courses, or what's going on now?
Right now we're 100% online. Mm-hmm. Even the technique classes, which is a little challenging.
Oh, yeah.
You have to trust the students a lot to be able to practice. Mm-hmm. So,
go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
Are you doing a private instructor to student Zoom room to see their technique? Are they practicing on mannequins? How are you handling those practicals?
Well, right now, what I'm trusting the students to be able to do is practice upon whoever they're trapped in the house with. Okay. So it's really rough. Once we get past this, they're going to be making it. They'll be having makeup days to make up some of the stuff that they've missed. So techniques was we were always thinking about going online with the book classes like anatomy, kinesiology, pathology. But this COVID thing has thrown us into a bit of a tailspin, so we had to just try it real quick. But once this is passed, though, they'll have X amount of time to do some makeup stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Live and supervised.
And this is obviously going to postpone a couple graduations, or is it they're surging forward and it shouldn't affect that?
It shouldn't affect it. Maybe push it back maybe a week or two, but it's not. That's the worst case scenario.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. So the bigger challenge is the students are getting ready to go into the clinic right now. Right. That closed down first and fast.
Sure.
So, the bigger minds than mine are working on that problem. So.
Now, Kevin, are you massaging outside of WellSpring? Are you working as an independent or?
In normal life, I have an independent practice where I am mobile. I go to my clients' homes, and then I work for a chiropractor here in town.
Oh, how wonderful. Yeah, you got a great resume then.
That's why I can't grow hair anymore.
And how are you doing personally?
Let's see, I'm on season 6 of Star Trek The Next Generation.
How many seasons are there in that one? There's a lot.
I hear there's 7.
Wow.
Wow, you made great progress.
I have no life right now. No, I shut down. Well, the chiropractor closed down for a week, and then that became a month. Mm-hmm. And then my private practice, you know, fortunately, my clients are very loyal. And so I talk to them weekly, seeing how they're doing. I just don't see anybody right now.
Right. Right. And to me, that's one of the worst things. Obviously, you know, people getting sick and things changing. To me, the personal touch aspect of this whole thing, you know, I don't underestimate it, but you really think about it a lot when you mm-hmm. cannot touch people. Well, and that's your job. It's well, like, no.
And I think most of my fellow massage therapists were huggy people.
Yes.
And, you know, you start going, and reach out for a big hug and catch yourself. Let me turn it off.
I've done it with handshakes. Reached out, and it's like, oh gosh, yeah, no, I can't shake your hand. You know,
I think that's a problem that's going to be with us for a while. Mm-hmm. I know everybody's kind of anxious to get back to work, but if I look in my crystal ball right now, I think people are going to be leery of touch in general, and whether that's a haircut or massage. That's
right.
It's going to be, we're doing this for a while.
I think it will change things significantly long term, really.
Yeah, and I think that it's really important too, Kevin and Susan, that's one of the reasons we need to really be proactive with our clientele and with the community and with the public overall, because they don't realize that we are governed by a lot of the same boards that the medical industry is governed by, especially the massage therapy industry. And so we understand the things and the steps that need to be taken to mitigate client infection and safety. And so to come back to us to get services is probably one of the safest things you'll do. And because it will be more safe than just going to Walmart. So I think if all of us make sure we tell our clients, you know, don't let this stop you. In fact, I feel like that we were essential, and because of how we're regulated, this was one industry that they didn't have any business shutting down. Now, that's my personal opinion, but I also understand the need to limit the amount of contact that people come in with each other. So now, with us really taking this seriously and trying not to talk to, you know, get in 6 feet of anybody else, we'll see how it starts to slow down. I heard on the news yesterday that there is some slowing down of new cases being reported. So that, to me, gives me some hope. And so we'll see what happens. But I think as far as coming back, I think that's going to be a message that the industries together have to really work together to get out, that this is one of the safest places you could come.
Absolutely. And it's, you know, there's going to be, well, I know WellSprings, we're really pushing the cleanliness and the hygiene aspect of it. Private practice is going to be that on steroids, so you're going to have to be really aware of your taking care of the client, how you sanitize things and how you don't. And the rest of it's going to be a lot of client education. I know there's going to be people who disagree with me out there. Where I see there's going to be some, the ones that are in medical massage or have medical massage background, I think they'll go back to work faster than the average, that's not true, than the other massage therapists.
That are in it for luxury.
Yeah. And I think that's, you know, what I foresee is that happening. And I think that's just human nature. Mm-hmm. It's there's going to be that huge chunk of clients that look at this as arbitrary touch.
Mm-hmm. Not me. it's necessary.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Well, yeah, I know there's a lot of different opinions out there, and I really hope that we do recover from all this, but I don't know that we're ever fully going to get over. You know, I think once we have that specific protocol, this is how it's contracted, this is how it's spread, and this is how you prevent it, ABC, really, really direct, instead of all this different stuff going on, I think that's going to help us a lot, which I think we're getting closer to that.
Yep.
But And Kevin, what? So you're in private practice of WellSpring. What are you foreseeing as our go back date?
Oh God!
Let's get that crystal ball out, shall we, Kevin?
Looking into the crystal ball, I really, on the low end, or the closest date I think is going to be May 1st. Mm-hmm. Opening anytime between that. The media, whichever side you're on, is not giving us, or not calming our clients down.
They make money on drama and inciting to riots, if you will. Yeah. I shouldn't say that, but it's true. They just love sensationalism. I don't know when the days shifted from, you know, presenting the facts to sensationalism, but it has, and this is the climate we live in. I'm personally shooting for the April 25th date that the mayor has laid down for us, you know, that 30 days. I've got appointments on the books the following Tuesday after that Saturday, and I'm shooting for that date, and I'm crossing my fingers, and I'm going to try to manifest that as much as possible, that they said 30 days, and they're going to stick to their word on the 30 days. So unless there's this crazy rush of people collapsing in the streets, I have every intention of going back to work. Because I feel like we create such a safe environment for the public. But again, we'll do what we're told for a while. Because people got to eat.
And I think that's something that you're going to have to look at. And I think as an industry, you know, most of us are independent contractors.
Right.
And, you know, there is no safety net for us. Mm-hmm. So when something like this happens, which thank God is rare, what do you do?
Mm-hmm. Well, I do think it's going to say a lot, especially about the educational industry, on how we teach the business practices for our adult learners that are coming out of vocational colleges, that you, if you intend to, and especially like in massage and cosmetology and aesthetics and nails, you know, the trend is to just come out and rent a space or be purely commissioned and be as independent as you can, because we are all these, a lot of us want the, probably 80% of the people coming in want that freedom of autonomy and independence. But that being said, you're also responsible for the failure or success of your own career. So if you're being taught in best business practices to take 10 cents out of every dollar you make and put it aside every single week and never touch it for things like this, and that becomes part of your business practice, I think we'll see a shift in this, that if something like this should happen again, our industry will be better prepared. So we can't always just like turn to the government or a handout to fix us. I think we're going to have to change how we do business, how we practice our business skills. There's that Parkinson's law, right? In business, that if you have it, you'll consume it.
Mm-hmm. I just finished teaching a business class about a month ago. And the first night they were like, wow, you are all doom and gloom. And this was before the crime. And I'm like, no, I'm teaching from experience. This is not going to be all roses. You can't just open a shop and hang a shingle out front and say, I'm open for business. What are the downsides to that? Mm-hmm. Have you met all the requirements by, say, Overland Park that require handicap accessibility? Mm-hmm. If not, think about that.
There's a lot that goes into it.
Absolutely.
Oh my gosh.
I think that if we give them a dose of reality right up front, it's like, mm-hmm. that will help solve that problem.
Mm-hmm. Well, and in your industry, Kevin, don't you think yours is even harder to navigate, because with massage therapy license, unlike estheticians, cosmetologists, nail technicians, and barbers, we are all under a specific board. And while you have a national board, the states haven't come on and said, okay, we acknowledge this board and we're going to make a national licensing for you. And so you're mitigated by city to city.
Oh, absolutely.
And what, what you can do in Overland Park, you can't do in Miriam, and what you can do. Right. And so where you even put your business in our community, you can't just put it anywhere you want. There's certain areas of the city that they say, no, you can't place it here. Yeah. Or, you know, because I think there's an old stigma still attached, and who can believe it, you know, of for massage set parlors, you know, from like what, the 1930s? I don't know why they have that crazy, like, you gotta go get fingerprinted. I don't have a massage therapy license in my business in Overland Park. It's $300 a year just for that. Right. And to allow massage therapy to take place in my facility. And then my massage therapist, you know, they have to get their CEUs, and then they have to renew their license every year.
Right.
And it's $150, which in cause all, you know, what is it for 2 years, Susan, 45 or 50? Yeah. It's super affordable. I've always said raise the rates, but because.
Yep. They might now.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You ever see the states coming together? And at least I know Missouri is better than Kansas. Kansas is, you know, I work with employment in the industry, and it is a nightmare.
Oh, yeah. I think Kansas is going to be on board soon.
Okay, good.
You know, and that's one thing I would really stress to, you know, everybody that's, that watches this. Next time the bill goes before the House in Topeka, go be a presence at that meeting. Mm-hmm. We need to be standardized across the state. Now, I don't see us being nationally, or one big national bubble. That would be nice. It'd be easy to read.
Right.
But I don't see it happening.
Mm-hmm. No, it's definitely a state-by-state deal. It's up to the governors and their legislatures, and, you know, and you have to be very proactive. I would love to see us be nationalized to the level that the physicians and nurses and lawyers and chiropractors, you know, they can go state to state, and most they have to do is do a written test just on their own state laws, and you're all good to go. You don't have to go back to school because your hours are short, or, you know, if there's a standard. And this may raise standards, you guys. I mean, us being, I think we're going to see such exciting new things. Like you were saying, Kevin, your school was always talking about going online. Mm-hmm. And I do think that there's some real value in allowing a certain amount of your academics to be done through distance learning, and then come in for your labs, and then come in for your clinics. And I think it really is more freeing for people who have put off getting into a vocation because those clock hours are so difficult to meet. You know, and it's like going to work and paying to work. It is. Mm-hmm. So I'd love to see it change and evolve.
I would like to see it change. Doing it the way we did it is, I'm still trying to figure out this technology. It's like, you know, sometimes the students can see me, sometimes they can't, sometimes I can see them, sometimes they can't. So this was trial by fire. It's smoothing out now. But yeah, I think that's everything you just said was true.
Do you guys get a lot of your textbooks through Cengage?
That I'm not sure.
I was thinking the textbook companies could really step up here and create a lot of their, and I know that Cengage, like from Milady, has, they have MindTap, they have different things where the students can do all of their academics on an iPad or a computer, but it would be great if they could integrate it into the school so that when they clock in and do the work that the schools can track the hours and see the actual work. Let's get a hold of the textbooks companies and see what we can make happen. And they may very well do that. I don't know. I no longer own a vocational college, but I would think that would be pretty awesome to do.
Very true.
Kevin, is there anything else that's on your mind you'd like to talk about?
Not really. I think you guys covered it well.
Well, good. Cool.
Well, we appreciate you taking the time to talk to us today, Kevin. We really do. We feel like massage therapy is part of that whole head-to-toe wellness and beauty in our industry, and really needed, especially for the technicians. I've got to tell you, you know, you stand on your feet with your arms out in front of you all day doing hair. You sit at a chair semi-hunched over doing nails. You're sitting there with your arms in front of you doing movements and things in a facial room. Our bodies get locked, and they have this muscle memory. And even in spray tanning, sometimes I'm in there spray tanning and I'll do 10 or 15 women in a day. And, you know, the squatting, the getting up, the moving, the arm, and holding a gun that, you know, weighs 4 pounds for 10 hours straight. It just, the tension it gives you. So we can't thank you enough for being in our industry. And
when you feel broken, you know, reach out and give me a call.
No need to call. Pretty much a puzzle pieces here. Put me back together. So, but we do want to thank you. And before we go, we do want to continue to mention about our Salon Spa Connection fundraiser for if you're a massage therapist who is struggling, if you are esthetician, nail technician, cosmetologist, barber, and you are struggling through this and you're not sure how you're going to come out the other end, Susan is doing a fundraiser on the Salon Spa Connection. We're looking for vendors and for people to donate, and she's going to tell us a little bit about that and where they can go.
Yeah, so we, you know, our industry is pretty wide, and there's so many people that are not necessarily planning for disasters like this. So we're a platform for people to sign up for privately for relief, and that would be hairstylists, barbers, nail technicians, massage therapists, and estheticians. No strings attached, just looking to get donations from, you know, anyone who feels like donating, anyone who has the wherewithal to do that. And so that could be in the form of money, gift certificates, baby items, you know, whatever anybody has to give, we would gladly accept. So please go to salonspaconnection.com right there on the homepage. And we would love to have a little bit of contribution, especially from our big corporate entities, our product companies, maybe our grocery stores. So
Cryoderm, if you're listening. Ashley back with her fascia blasters.
Yeah. Well, and it's good. We're happy to promote anybody that does send us a donation. And so that is what we're doing, just trying to help people through this time. And, you know, I'm hopeful that we'll be back May 1st. However, I've got family in Dallas, and they were just put off to the May 20th. Ugh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So anyway, yeah. And then, you know, unemployment, hopefully that starts to come in, and hopefully all these little wheels that look to be in motion actually start turning for us financially. So far I have not seen it, but
it will come. It will come. And you know, it's a funny thing about life and challenges, you know, one of the greatest advices my father gave me growing up, because sometimes we didn't know where we were going to be. He was a musician and we traveled around a lot, and one of the greatest things he ever told me was, you know, just don't worry about the day. At the end of the day takes care of itself, and less than 2% of what you worry about is actually going to happen to you. So put that energy into something positive, and that's what we're hoping people will do. They'll put it into positive and reach out to help those who can't help themselves. And thank you so much for coming on and sharing with us, Kevin and Susan. I'll see you tomorrow. And once again, thanks for watching the COVID Countdown. And everybody, thanks. Have a great day. All right, bye.
Bye.